On the earlier occasions, in pursuance of my assurance that during the COVID lockdown period, we will regularly interact with you and share with you all the steps that we are taking, steps that we were contemplating, and large initiatives in order to deal with a situation which, at least in our lifetime, has had no precedent. We have all dealt with viruses from the days that I was accredited as ambassador to the UN in Geneva, in New York. I was accredited to the World Health Organization, and I'm reasonably familiar with how the international community responded to viruses, pandemics, SARS, H1N1, swine flu, Ebola, etc. But the COVID-19 pandemic, if you compare it to the other situations that I have mentioned, is in many ways unique. And in fact, the only situation you can compare COVID-19 to is the Spanish flu of 1918. SARS had a mortality rate of 17%. We have been successful in India. We started with a mortality rate of 3% or so, but we brought it substantially down. But it is the very comprehensive and effective measures that the Prime Minister took, which has saved us from a consequence that could have been devastating. Today, because of the lockdown, we've had the time to produce an health infrastructure, and I'll come to Lifeline Udaan in a few minutes. We were able to get other systems in place. Today, our positive rate is what, in the vicinity of 5% or so. We are testing in very large numbers, and the graph is not only stable, but I think coming down. This gives us the confidence, the effective management of the response to COVID, to deal with civil aviation also with a sense of confidence. On 6th March, when we met for the first time, I acquainted you with the measures we had taken to screen passengers coming in at the international airports, thermal screening and other measures which you took. On 2nd April, when we met, we spoke about Lifeline Udaan, and I want to share with you the figures on Lifeline Udaan by any yardstick, no matter which way you look at it. These are very impressive figures. We brought in something like 1,500 plus tons of medical equipment and other medical supplies which were required to be imported from other countries, and Air India played a very important role, as did some of our other carriers, but the burden was essentially borne by Air India. Domestically, Lifeline Udaan also produced and necessitated a total kilometerage coverage of 5,45,685 kilometers. 588 total flights were carried out, and the total cargo load carried domestically was 940.29 tons. And I stand corrected, the total medical cargo brought from outside was not 1,500 plus. Yes, it was 1,500 plus, but is 1,928 tons. So if I have to round off, I should round off at 2,000, not at 1,500. Medical supplies which were sent by us to foreign countries in our neighborhood and other parts of the world was in excess of 30 tons. Now, as you will see, it's only a country which has its systems in place, which has clear, decisive political decision-making and direction, and where you were able to ensure that from PPE masks, from PPE kits, masks, ventilators, which were in very short supply or not possible, we not only transported them to all parts of the country, but if I may also add, we ramped up our own production. So today, since I'm talking about civil aviation and I want to for a moment go away from my role as a member of the GOM on health and COVID along with secretary, but let me come to the civil aviation part. So I think there's 550,000 kilometers which were carried, and the result is there to see. I mean, in the beginning, there was some dislocation. Some people complained. Some people who did not need PPE kits also asked for them. But, you know, very quickly the system fell in place. And today, I think we are not only in a position to say that we have consolidated our position as the pharmacy of the world. We were already suppliers of generics. But in terms of COVID-related medication and equipment, we are also now major suppliers to other countries in the world. On 5th May, when we met, I gave you the outlines of the Vande Bharat mission. And the starting point of the Vande Bharat mission was that the Minister for External Affairs was receiving requests, urgent pleas from many of our citizens stranded in different parts of the world, saying that they needed to be brought back, either because they had lost their jobs on account of the pandemic, or they needed to be deported, and as deportees. You see, on 23rd March, I should have said, but I know you are familiar with this, there was a complete lockdown, not only here, we stopped civil aviation, but so did most other countries. So if you were traveling and you were, let's say, on a holiday, or you'd lost your job, you needed to come back. Again, and I think I've shared this with you earlier, but I have no hesitation in repeating myself. When I asked Jaishankar ji, how many people do you think will need to be covered in this mission? And I was only asking the question because on the civil aviation side, we have to make the arrangements, provide the platforms for this carriage. So he said, well, you know, the Navy will join in, maybe one or two surface platforms, but about 190,000 people. I must share with you something I've already told you. I had serious doubts about this 190,000 figure, because I knew this was the figure which was suggested, or rather which suggested itself, because those are the number of people who registered. Now, in March, April, no one had any idea as to how many people would like to avail of this facility. Anyway, when we started the operation, we were clear it would be much more than 190,000. And secretary and my other senior colleagues here on the dais will bear with me. In our internal meetings, I said, prepare for many times that number. And you know, Vande Bharat, maybe Rajiv, CMD Air India, can tell you later. But when we started in the first week, we started on a modest scale. I think we brought back something like 14,000 people, 12,600 people. How much? 12,708 people, phase one. From what, 64 countries? Can say with confidence, I don't know what the last night's figures are. The number of people brought back is over 2 million. Brought back and taken out is over 2 million. So where 1.9 lakhs and where you are in excess of 20 lakhs. So that gives you again some idea about the scale on which the Vande Bharat has operated. I used to be asked questions, when are you starting international flights? When are you? I suspect at that stage we had not got our narrative properly across. To bilateral civil aviation, listed as a bridging arrangement between a situation of complete lockdown and no activity and complete opening up of civil aviation. So again, I think full marks to the Prime Minister, under whose clear inspiration, with whose inspiration, clear direction, he said, look, an Indian citizen stranded abroad has a claim on us, and that it is our duty. We could have been inward looking and say, bhai, ho gaya lockdown, hum na. And Vande Bharat flight started before domestic flights. I want to make this a point. So I don't know what the number of Indians abroad is. I spent 40 years in the Foreign Service. I've heard figures like 25 million Indians outside. Not all of them are Indian passport holders. Some of them, but many of them are Indian origin and feel very strong ties to the country. But I can tell you, the Prime Minister's decision that Indians stranded abroad have a claim on us, or his decision that Indians who are here and need to go back to reclaim their jobs, we rose to that occasion. And I think we are now in phase seven. I don't know if it's six continues or seven. Six continues, and Rajiv would be happy to answer specific questions on that. On 21st May, when we met, I spoke to you about resumption of domestic civil aviation. And I want to relay a story which I may have, maybe I tend to repeat myself, but I got a call from one of the airline operators, and it was early April. And recall that we had stopped domestic civil aviation around 23rd or 25th of March. And he asked me, should we plan for the year ahead on the presumption that there will be no revenue till September? That was a question. I immediately responded saying that is not my analysis. In fact, I believe that we will be able to start domestic civil aviation in the month of May, we are speaking in April, and that by September you will have a substantial amount of traffic already in place. I must say, this is an airline operator. He was polite to me, but he didn't contradict me. But he told me later, you were right, but I had my misgivings. We started on 25th May. I had told him we'll start around 15th May. That was our internal assessment. You know, you have to navigate with the health authorities, you have to navigate with the state governments, and the state governments have a very important role to play, because as the Prime Minister said, in our system of cooperative federalism, that fight against corona has to be not only conducted from Delhi, but it has to be done at the district level, at the state level. The state governments have a very important role to play, and the Prime Minister himself has been talking to state governments, getting their views, and then we've been setting templates. But look, we started on 25th May, the passenger traffic on 25th May, as a result of 33% slow calibrated opening up, was 30,000 passengers, I think, to begin with. I'm not consulting my statistics, but my colleagues will correct them. The figure on 2nd October or 3rd October was 1,76,000. I had always said that the 50% mark will be the difficult one to reach, because you have to deal not only with the behavior of the virus, you have to deal with restrictions imposed by state governments, quarantine, other restrictions. But once you cross the 50% mark, it's going to gather. So I want to take this opportunity to tell you, it is my assessment, all other things being equal, and Secretary and I have a running bet on this as to whose figures are right. But we are both of us in the same band, and I'm going to defer to his figure. His figure is that by the end of October, we will be at 200,000. My own figure is that faster, but today, for the sake of the press conference, I'll say his figure, 200,000. Pre-COVID was 300,000. Now I'm going to take a step further. Diwali will be on 15th November, I think thereabouts, between Diwali and the end of the year, we will not only reach pre-COVID levels of 300,000, but my expectation is going into the first quarter of next year, we will go past that also. Why do I feel comfortable and confident to make this assertion? When you are in a lockdown position, people can either decide that they don't have anything to do with air travel. I think very early in the day, we were able to demonstrate that amongst all the forms of transportation, air travel is one of the safest. I choose my words carefully. Nothing is totally safe in today's day and age. It may not be entirely safe for me to be in a room with so many people, but one has to intelligently take some risks. And with the ventilation systems inside the aircraft, nozzle, roof down, ventilation, etc., I think internationally it's been established that airline travel is relatively safe. And as we have opened up first 33%, in the first few weeks, we were not even getting the 33% utilization. Then we slowly opened up to 50, then to 60, 65 or so. Today, we are past 150,000 on any day. Even when you have a bad day, you're at 155, 160. But I think end of October and then the festive season, and now people are beginning to travel also, and I see this from airline associations and others who carry out these surveys. What are our plans going forward? Well, we are presently at the 60-65% opening, but I can share with you that our internal thinking is that we will watch it for another week or 10 days, and we will have no hesitation after that, if the figures continue to be healthy, to open up civil aviation to 75% of pre-COVID levels. Exact dates, etc. Why do I say this? You know, Mumbai is a classic case to study. Pre-COVID, I think Mumbai used to have what, 1,000 flights a day, 500 arrivals, 500 departures?
1,000 movements, yeah.
1,000 movements, that's 500 arrivals, 500. Mumbai was also very slow to start off. We got in the beginning only 25 and 25. So I used to negotiate with the chief minister. I was more unsuccessful than successful, but I kept trying. Slowly we got it raised to 50 arrivals and 50 departures. I recall seeing a message from the state government that they are taking it up to 30% level. 30% levels means 300 plus. So if we are moving from 100 to 300, that's a huge jump. And if my inputs are right, those additional 200 flights are now being put in place. They have not been availed of as yet, which means your figure of 1,76,000, which we had 7 days ago, about a week ago, that will easily be above 200,000. And once you're at 200,000, you're at 60-66% of that, then, you know, even as a cautious minister, I say, if you're 60-66%, you'll get 75 by, you're going to open up and you will get your pre-COVID figures. Last time, then we, on 20th June, we spoke on overall civil aviation scenario, exactly covering all these issues. On 16 July, we spoke on drone operations, an update on Vande Bharat. Meanwhile, you know, it's not been easy. We had this whole challenge on the middle seat. We were able to navigate our way through that. Then we had this, no, it's not a challenge for me. I was very clear from day go that if somebody collects fares, advanced fares, and you don't carry out the flight, you have to pay it back. So DGCA, who should have been sitting here, but because of the Dias connection, he came up with a very good plan with the ministry. And my assessment is that the court, by and large, accepted in that plan. And so that's the law now. And so we have been able to deal with that situation. And the details, if you need, Secretary will mention. There are also issues relating to Krishi Udan, which again is a very major initiative and I think has great potential. We also have air safety was an issue which is of concern, and I can just share some statistics with you, because you know, a lot of people who after their active professional lives I want to tell you, I've looked at scheduled commercial aircraft accidents, that's aircraft above 5,700 kgs per million flights. I've looked at the world figure, India, USA, UK, Australia, and Canada. Let me just give you the figure of 2019, okay? The global figure is 3.02, India is 0.82, USA is 4.09, UK is 6.42, Australia is 2.72, Canada is 4.45. Then I compare the Indian figure from 2014 to 2019. It's very interesting. Global figure for accidents per million flights, 3.06, India is 2.8. 2015, 2.82, India 5.1. 2016, 2.21, India 3.3. Then comes the fall. 2017, 2.44, 1. 2018, 2.61, 0.8. 2019, 3.02, 0.82. Now, what we have done on air safety in the last few years, that is brought out. Now, again, a few things on air safety. This is reflected from the fact that the US safety regulator, which had downgraded India to Category 2 status in 2014, upgraded us to Category 1 in April 2015, after significant steps were taken by DGCA to ensure air safety. India is currently placed in Category 1. Countries like Pakistan, Bangladesh, Thailand, Malaysia in Category 2. Indian skies are safe. Effective implementation of safety standards by DGCA has resulted in considerable improvement from 57% in 2017 to 72% in 2018. And I want to finally conclude by that DGCA received the ICAO Council President Certificate for this achievement in the 2019 Assembly. I believe we were there at that stage of time. Yeah, you were. Okay. Now, I am going to conclude with this. We have enough time. I'm open to any question. But first, I want to airport privatization and some other. I think I should deal with that for a minute. One of the issues which is often raised is what have we done for the airlines in this during this period. Where is that sheet? Yeah. In January 2020, the fuel throughput charge was rationalized. Airport operators will not directly put this charge on airlines. Rather, Airport Economic Regulatory Authority of India, AERA, will regulate this fees. Central excise duty on aviation turbine fuel, or ATF, was reduced from 11% in October 2018. The GST on MRO was reduced from 18% to 5% with full input tax credit from 1st April 2020. This will attract the MRO business to India, leading to a lot of savings for airlines in maintenance and creation of jobs. Till now, only 60% of airspace was available for civil aviation movement. Now these restrictions are proposed to be eased out, so that civilian flight operations will become more efficient and save time and money for passengers and airlines. This airspace rationalization is likely to save rupees 1,000 crore per annum for airline. The proposal to bring ATF under the GST ambit is before the GST Council, which has representation from states as well. And finally, privatization of airports. Only yesterday, the paperwork, rather, a signature was done for Jewar Airport between the concerned authorities in UP and the Zurich Airport. Is it? Out of the six airports for which bids were invited in the first round, the concessionaire agreement was signed in February 2020 for three: Ahmedabad, Lucknow, and Mangaluru. due to COVID-19, the entity concerned cited force majeure and filed for extension in March 20 and sought time till February 2021. They have been given time for the remaining airports till 12 November 2020, and I am confident that the agreement for those three airports will be signed as well. The other three, Guwahati, Jaipur and Trivandrum, have also been approved for leasing out on PPP, and the letter of award has been issued to the concerned entity. We have now already moved to the next round of airports. At its board, the Board of the Airports Authority of India, on 5th September, recommendation was made to the Government of India for undertaking operations, management and development of another set of six airports. That is, those first we did two in 2006, Mumbai and Delhi in 2006. Then we invited bids in 2018, good 7 months before I became a minister on civil aviation. For six, those six are now on target. Three have already been given, the other three being given. Another six, which are through public-private partnership, Varanasi, Amritsar, Bhubaneswar, Raipur, Indore and Trichy. Modalities for this are being worked out. It is expected that additional investment of around 13,000 crores will be made by private players in the 12 airports. And I just want to conclude by giving you one broad statistic. And I won't talk about the six airports which we did or the six which we are now going to do. Six also I can give you. Because the then government decided to privatize Mumbai and Delhi airports, which constitute 33% of the traffic, the Airports Authority of India, as a result of that, till I think 2019 end, got an amount of 29,000 crores. It is that money, that 29,000 crores and whatever other resources they can raise, which has been utilized to develop the other airports in the country. That's very important. The six airports of which we'll be completing now, if memory serves me right, they will produce 2,300 crores. And an upfront payment of?
Upfront payment of about 1,000 crores in the first place.
1,000 crores and then another?
1,300.
Another 1,300 crores upfront.
Yes.
And then, of course, then there is a revenue sharing model, etc. So unless you privatize, and first you need to privatize in order to get scale. That scale and enhanced activity gives you an opportunity to increase your revenue, and that revenue increase, etc., helps you to develop the airport infrastructure. So I'm going to conclude with that. I'm going to ask my colleagues, starting with Secretary, if they would like to supplement this, and then we'll be open for questions. Pradeep.
Thank you, sir. On this occasion, I would just like to mention that we have reached a very important threshold at the moment, I would say a very important milestone. About 4.5 months back when we opened up the domestic aviation, that was an important milestone, and today is the second important one. At that time, we had put in a huge amount of measures to ensure that civil aviation, particularly the travel by civil aviation, becomes absolutely, I would say, almost safe. And all these measures have been validated, and if you look back and see, in the past 4.5 months, with the ridership has gone up, has increased. The passenger traffic has increased from 29,000 on first day to almost touching 1.8 lakhs, and a jump of virtually six times. Now this is quite unprecedented, and this also validates and it almost certifies that all the measures we took, the protective measures, the airlines, the airports, all of them took. They have been validated, and it has been established that these measures have really worked. The new normal, what we call the new normal, is that the passengers, when they travel through the airport, it's virtually contactless, it's paperless, people just walk in, it's 100% web check-in. No one could have ever imagined this about maybe 1 year or a couple of years back. So that's what we have achieved. Now, the increase from 50 to 100 is going to be faster, and that's a challenge before the airlines, and we had a detailed discussions with all the airports and the airlines yesterday only, where we said that now these protective measures have to be stepped up. Now with passenger traffic increasing, ensuing festival season, year end traffic, there would be more traffic on on the airports as well as the airlines. So all these airports and airlines have been asked to take up special measures to ensure proper hand hygiene, to ensure proper, everyone wears not only the face mask, we have a second layer called the face shield. Now that's the second layer of protection, and of course maintaining social distance and all. So all this has been done, and now we are gearing up for round two or the second phase, when we'll rapidly grow from 50% to almost near normal. So that's what the importance of this threshold point at this moment is. And second thing, what we have seen in the past a couple of weeks is that we had a big challenge for the consumers, for the travelers whose fare, the tickets were not being refunded. So we had proposed a scheme, and the Honorable Supreme Court almost put a stamp on the scheme which was proposed by DGCA. It upheld that primarily the money has to be refunded. But it struck a very, very delicate balance between the interest of the consumers on one hand and the interest of the airlines also. In fact, it has been very nicely worded, saying that if we really squeeze the airlines at this point of time, nothing would be left. So this balance has been struck, and a very nice formulation has been given by the Honorable Supreme Court, as per which, that if anyone traveled during lockdown, for lockdown, if you book a ticket, they were not supposed to do, that shall be given in cash. Post lockdown, after 25th of May, if anyone cancels tickets, it is nothing to do with COVID, it shall be refunded as cash as per CAR. Only the special dispensation is that people having booked tickets before lockdown period, for lockdown period, which could not have been foreseen, in that case, the money can be transferred to credit shells. And there also, a lot of facilities have been given that these credit shells are transferable. Means if I have a credit shell, I can sell it off to anyone. Not only that, if airlines delay all these encashment, if a passenger is not able to travel, there is a system where an interest accrues on the credit shell. So the credit shell swells with passage of time. And third and most important is the deadline is 31st of March 2021. After that, entire amount shall be given in cash. So these are the two major developments which have taken place in the recent 2 weeks. So I will just say that we have reached a very important milestone and gearing up for the second step, a second major step, which will take us from 50% to 100%. So thank you very much. So maybe we'll take questions afterwards.
Thank you, sir. Well, for us in Air India, I think the journey of 2020 has been one of calibrated growth, starting from the evacuation exercise that we undertook in Wuhan in January this year, to the commencement of the Vande Bharat mission on May 6th, moving on to the commencement of domestic operations from May 25th, and around the same time we started the air bubble arrangements. So steadily we have moved, and today I'm happy to note that we have, over the past few months, under the aegis of the Vande Bharat mission as well as the air bubble arrangements, carried almost 5.5 lakh passengers into India and transported about 3 lakh passengers out of India. So that's about 8.5 lakh passengers that we have been able to transport in these very challenging times. One very interesting aspect of this entire evacuation has been the large number of destinations that we've added onto our charts. We used to operate internationally to about 45 destinations, and these last 6 months have been very challenging for us, and we added as many as another 40 destinations. Destinations to which Air India has never flown earlier, to which no Indian carrier has flown earlier. We added Cebu in Philippines, we added Hanoi in Vietnam, Phnom Penh in Cambodia, Dublin we had never flown in Ireland, we added Bishkek in Kyrgyzstan, we added Dushanbe in Tajikistan, Boryspil in Ukraine, Minsk in Belarus, Akmola in Kazakhstan. So many new destinations we were able to add in this last 6 months. Another very interesting feature which happened under the guidance of our minister and the ministry has been these air bubble arrangements. We currently have arrangements with 16 countries, France, UK and Germany in Europe, Canada and USA in North America, Bahrain, Iraq, UAE, Oman and Qatar in the Middle East, Afghanistan, Bhutan and Maldives in our immediate neighbors, Kenya and Nigeria, in Africa and Japan. These air bubble arrangements have helped us provide a schedule of operations on a sustained basis. We now currently have a schedule which is open for booking for passengers right through the winter months up to, for some countries up to December and other countries up to March. So consumers and passengers have visibility on the flight schedule. They also have choice because carriers of these countries can also fly into India. So this has been an arrangement which has been quite unique in these challenging times, but it has stabilized and it has provided great comfort to passengers. I think going forward, some of the aspects which I would like to mention today is that we plan to expand our international reach. As I said, we've added about 40 destinations. We'll continue to add. Just recently, last month, we flew to Ningbo in China. We've added flights to Lagos, which was not on our circuit earlier. We plan to start operations to Addis Ababa, and that would provide a gateway to Africa. So we are continually striving to expand our reach internationally. So that is at one end, and at the other end, we do realize that for a country of our size, for our geography as well as populace, we cannot operate these flights from every point in India, and hence we are trying to add connectivity for both outgoing passengers as well as incoming passengers. So we are traditionally a hub and spoke carrier. We provide spokes which feed into our international flights, which largely originate from Delhi and Mumbai. But we've added flights from, for example, we've added Cochin to London. We've added flights from Kolkata to London. So we are expanding our reach within the country for both outward traffic as well as for inward traffic. For example, we have flights which come in from various destinations in US to Delhi, and then we provide spokes which reach out to various smaller cities like Amritsar, Lucknow, Bhopal, Indore, Ahmedabad, like that. So the whole idea is to provide convenience to passengers, provide a range of options so that consumers and passengers have convenience and certainty of travel. Our airfares have come down. As our passenger loads have increased, our airfares have come down very significantly, and this has also helped our passengers. With these few words, I would like to conclude.
Thank you very much, sir.
I just wanted to, Secretary has drawn my attention to one other area which has shown very impressive increase, which is the cargo handling. And I'll just spend a minute on that. You know, since 2014, and that's always a good reference point for me in my new profession, our growth has been 60% since then. And within cumulated growth rate, annual growth rate of over 8.4%. That's annual growth rate of over 8.4%, 60% growth since 2014. We've come from 2006, 1.55 million metric tons to 3.56 million metric tons. Now, I've been saying for a long time that when you look at statistics, look at them sensibly. For instance, some economist or somebody who had a nodding acquaintance with the dismal sign put out a figure that the Indian economy had contracted 23.9% according to some figures. I had to point out that those were the figures for April, May, and June. Now, April 23rd, March, we had a lockdown. There was no economic activity, virtually no economic activity in April, very little till the end of May. So, I mean, similarly on cargo, if you look at the September 20 figures compared to September of 2019, it's only down by 15%. So, if after all this, now GST figures for April, I just want to remind you, not April, August of 2020 were 92% of the figure for August of 2019. Okay, 92%. But when you looked at the September figure, they were 4% higher than the September figure of the previous year. Similarly, air cargo. Why am I focusing on civil aviation. Because civil aviation is both a very good indicator of the state of the economy, it's also a critical driver of economic growth. It works both ways. So if you look at the September figure, it's only 15% less than the previous year's figure. There's another story here, which I would maybe sit down in a smaller group with those of you who are interested, how Indian carriers are now looking at the cargo carriage much more effectively than they were doing pre-COVID. Look, I'm one of those who says we'll come out of COVID, thanks to Atmanirbharta and all the other actions taken by the Prime Minister, much stronger than we were pre-COVID. What does that mean? We'll have more domestic traffic than we did pre-COVID. That means 300,000 plus. Our international traffic will increase. Our carriers are getting wide-bodied, I'm talking about private carriers, are getting wide-bodied planes, not as quickly as I would want, but then, you know, I don't take commercial decisions. I only sit with my colleagues here and try and work out an ecosystem of policy decision. More cargo being carried by Indian carriers, more wide-bodied aircraft to carry international passage. And I think, I mean, it's a mind-boggling figure. Air India, which used to fly to 80, 60 or 80 domestic and 40 destination out, it's flying to 45 additional destinations. So if you look at the real facts, hard facts, I don't know by the time Rajiv, you know, COVID is over, whoever owns the airline at that point of time, whether they want to expand to all those countries or they want to, be content with, but some expansion is taking place. You have a footprint there. I mean, some places in Central Asia, I mean, the back feedback I'm getting is that there are very, you could open them up lucratively, equally places in the neighborhood, places in East Asia. So I just thought I'd point out to some of these additional factors. Airport privatization and airports are real activity, real economic activity, because an airport is not just catering to the passenger traffic. When you build an airport, build a good airport, the economic activity of the region also. So I'm not surprised. Earlier people used to want rail connection, now everybody wants an airport in his listing. So when I'm in Parliament, I'm one of the more sought after people, because they want Udaan connectivity, they want airports to be built, they want unserved, underserved members of Parliament I'm talking about. But I think Arvind can tell us about that and other issues. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. While on the subject of airport privatization, Honorable Minister has given you the details of where we are and vis-a-vis the first round of six airports and where we are vis-a-vis the second round of six airports that we are doing. So if there are specific questions, I'll take them during the question hour. But I would like to bring to your notice one development that has taken place in the last month, where the Airport Authority Board and the Ministry have approved a new policy for encouraging flying training organizations. Essentially, what we mean is flying schools. Most of you would be aware that we need a large number of pilots in the future, given the speed and scale at which the aviation sector is expanding. And unfortunately, today 30% of the pilots in the country have to go abroad for training. There is a shortage of training capacity in the country, and so people have to spend precious foreign exchange and own resources to go and get trained abroad. And one of the reasons we found was that the existing flying training schools, which were at most of our airports, were in all kinds of trouble, financial trouble and other trouble. And they were not able to, take measures to expand their capacity. So the Airports Authority had set up a committee under the chairmanship of Air Chief Marshal Fali Major, former chief of the Air Force, who was on the board of the Airports Authority. And on the basis of its recommendations, the ministry has recently taken a decision where we have identified six airports where there is not much flying activity. These are relatively smaller airports, but adequate land and other resources are available. So we would come out with a policy to encourage flying training organizations to set up shop at these six airports. And these airports are Belgavi, Jalgaon, Kalaburgi, Khajuraho, Leelabari, and Salem. So we will be coming out with a request for proposals for these six airports in the first phase. I'll repeat: Belgavi, Jalgaon, Kalaburgi, Khajuraho, Leelabari, and Salem. And there is a host of concessions that we are doing. We have reduced the concession fee and other concessions on in the charges that we were charging to the flying school, so that it becomes a, there is an incentive for private operators to come and set up. And we'll be selecting the operators at these airports through a process of competitive bidding and maybe international competitive bidding to attract players from all parts of the world. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. I think we can take the question, sir. Sir, first online question. In fact, we discussed travel bubble arrangements in details here. The related question is, there are reports that the travel bubble arrangements will continue till March. Is it true, and what are the plans to make these arrangements?
You know, this is a question which is purely in the realm of speculation, whether the travel arrangement will continue till March or earlier or later. I have felt, and I've said this many times, that in order to bring international civil aviation back to pre-COVID arrangements, you need to do three things. One is you need to have your domestic civil aviation cross the 50% mark. Why? Because international flights don't come into smaller cities, they come to major cities. So the passenger who's coming in, getting off at Kolkata, Bangalore, Mumbai, Delhi, must be able to get a connect. I think that part we have more or less achieved. Sure. The second is the behavior of the virus. That's something on which I am very hesitant to comment. I mean, if you look at, I have a chart of countries who has opened up, because on the behavior of the virus will depend on the entry conditions which are imposed by countries. And if anybody is interested, I can read out those entry conditions. There are very few countries in the world today, hardly any, which have totally open borders. Everybody allows their citizens to come. Some of them allow other people to come, but with conditions. You know, visas, even existing visas need to be have revalidated. Will that happen by March? That's the thrust of the question. Yes, I frankly don't know. But I would like to plan, thinking that as we go ahead, as we go into the end of the year, we should now then start planning, whether it happens in March or April or May or June. Sir. But it also will depend on when there is a readily available vaccine. Because countries will feel more confident when frontline warriors and others have access to the vaccine. But all I can say is, if you, for the purposes of preparing for a discussion, yes, March or thereafter.
Okay. Sir, what is the status of negotiations on Germany's Lufthansa flight to India?
Well, you know, it's quite simple. What happened is that even prior to this, you see, under the bubble arrangement, airlines provide schedules to their counterparts some days in advance. So I think the Lufthansa had an authorization till 30th September. But during the period prior to that, I think they were operating, what, 21 flights a week? We were operating only three. So this is normal commercial negotiation. I think they were given, it's not that there was a breakdown, they were given seven flights, etc. I think they wanted more. So I think I'll let Secretary answer the operative part. I'm just giving you the background here.
I think Lufthansa, about the agreement with Germany, we have had the first round of talks on Tuesday. And they were in very, very, very congenial atmosphere, very constructive talks, and they put forth their viewpoint, we put forth our viewpoint, and we are sure that we will be meeting them maybe tomorrow or in a day or two once again, and this air bubble arrangement would be finalized with Germany.
Sir, a question on the concessions to Air India. Any new concessions government is planning for Air India's sale?
I think that question on privatization of Air India should be answered by Secretary rather than CMD, because CMD has to run the airline.
Yes,
and he has to prepare everything. But I think Secretary, it's better that Secretary answer it. You can supplement it.
The bid process of Air India is underway, and already the PIM, the Preliminary Information Memorandum, has been issued, and the last date for submission of expression of interest is this month end. Now, there are various suggestions which are being discussed, and whether how to ensure that this investment of Air India goes on successfully. So these discussions are taking place at appropriate levels, and a suitable decision would be taken very soon. And accordingly, based on the decisions, the process of disinvestment to Air India would be taken further.
We take the question from here. 20, Palome.
So my question was on the capping of the capacity of flight operations and fares as well, which was, as per the last year, up till November 24th. Are we looking at any sort of revision vis-a-vis that?
Okay, I get it. Yeah. You know, when we did the first fare ban, which was in the month of May end. The reason why we had done it, which I had shared with you, was that when you suddenly open up after a closed down situation, the possibility of distortions, very severe distortions coming in, is that if people, for instance, start selling at throwaway prices tickets, like there were situations like, I think pre-COVID, Mumbai, Delhi used to be sold at something like 1,000 rupees?
Even below 1,000 rupees.
Now, in a situation of, you know, closure and desperation, that will happen and everybody will. So we fixed a floor price and we fixed a ceiling price. The floor price was not too low. I think Mumbai, Delhi is about 3,500?
4,000.
But 4,000. And the top fare is 10,000. And then, now, when we, we'll consider this, but I can tell you that price band has served its purpose. And I shouldn't say this, but not all airlines are unhappy with it either. So, but this is a measure designed for a specific purpose. We only have to take a call on when, and we haven't done that exercise yet. So at some stage, we will have to revisit that. I think, but the current one is operational till end November. If I'm, would you like to add something to this?
As was pointed by the Honorable Minister, these fare bands were fixed in such a way that the lower one is kept more or less at AC travel by train.
First class AC.
First class AC, even less than that.
Yeah.
And the upper one was kept about two to two and a half times. So that we ensure that there is no huge amount of rush for the air travel. At the same time, we ensure that the interest of passengers is safeguarded by putting an upper ceiling. So it has helped the passengers also on one hand, and it has helped the airlines also on the other hand.
16.
Ashwini Fadnis from the Hindu Business Line. Sir, just wanted to check with you, since the government wants to get back Indians from every nook and corner of the world. Pre-COVID, there were over 50 international airlines operating. Would you look at enhancing the number of international airlines who want to fly into India? Thank you.
Mr. Fadnis, I'll give you some statistics which will provide a good indication of how much foreign airlines. Even during this period, number of flights up to 30th September carried out by Indian carriers were 2,260, other than Air India. Number carried out by foreign carriers was 5,151, 2.5 times the thing. I would be very happy to share with you other statistics. The issue is not allowing foreign carriers in or not. We are all foreign carriers are operating here, make no mistake. But I think the time has come for the message to go out loud and clear that that will not be done at the expense of the Indian carriers. We have a situation, I'll tell you, from the Middle East also. We have brought back under VBM 5,27,404 people from UAE, 1,00,000 90,000 from Saudi Arabia. If you look at the number of foreign carriers, our carriers, foreign carriers have as much of a load carrying. But what happened earlier is, let me give you an example. The India-US market, I'm broad figures, is worth about $7 billion or so. But the share of Indian carriers in that was only 17%. And it's not as if the American carriers were getting the balance of it. So what we are doing is, under the regulated arrangements, we are not insisting on total parity. Even near parity will do. So if I am, now for instance, what's happening with India and the US, Rajiv, correct me, you're flying, what, 23 flights a week? Or more, perhaps? 30 flights Air India carries out between India and the US. And the US also carry out that much? Slightly less. So that's all right. We carry out 30 flights, they carry out 23, but they may put another 20. But there's some parity business. The same is the case now with in the Gulf and the Middle East. We have both flight and passenger. I'm not saying parity, but you know, it should not look completely uneven. So let me be clear. I mean, I you know, 40 years in another profession, I choose my words carefully. There is opportunity in India for all foreign economic entities. But equally, where commercial advantage is concerned, we also expect our carriers, when they go in there, also to get these facilities. And therefore, we are very confident that we've already worked out. With most countries in the world, it's done. With the UK, it's working. How many flights are you doing to the UK? 14 flights a week. UK carriers will come, our carriers will go, but we are open. We are open to the idea. If there is demand, we would like economic activity. Certainly, we don't want passengers. If there ever we are finding that the passenger is suffering, no, we will even overlook that point. But you cannot have a situation if they have entry restrictions for Indians to come into their country. Indians can't go there. And there aren't so many people from their country. But if the arrangement is being carried out only for six freedom rides, then obviously, you know, we would want parity because we have direct flights between us and the US and us and Canada. And we would like the Canadian and US carrier. So that is simply it. So there is no difficulty in negotiation either. Once the message goes home, I think we can do, and all foreign carriers are operating here. I've been flying a bit in the last few days. You can, you know, wherever you want to go, there are, and we are opening up as we go along.
15.
Yes. So my question is, I have a combined question. You've painted a very positive picture of the aviation industry, but you know, more than six months into the pandemic, every business entity is talking about the kind of losses that they're staring at. We never get to hear about the losses that the two government entities here, Air India and AI, are staring at. Air India has been in a better position as compared to other airlines and was able to have flights while the entire fleets of different airlines were grounded. Yet its losses have mounted according to the latest figures in Parliament. So can we get some sense of, you know, what has been the international and domestic breakup of operational profits or income for Air India because of Vande Bharat? And similarly for AI, which has been asked to, you know, defer payments owed by various airlines, and an entity which is cash positive and earns profits every year is now looking at ways to seek a loan for its own working capital requirement. So can you please shed some light about AI and Air India?
Well, let me first say that, let me give you an overall comment and then Rajiv can answer, because yours is not a question. I think what you're seeking is an overall understanding of what's happening in the airline industry. Let me start with some basics. Airlines all over the world, airports all over the world, all concomitant attendant industries, tied tourism, hotels, everywhere in the world has had revenue losses because of XYZ, number one. Number two, different entities have responded differently. Those are commercial decisions. Now, insofar as Air India is concerned, because it's tied to the government, Air India, and I take great pride in that, we have been able to cut operating expenditure by something in the order of, Air India has not laid off a single employee. And I choose my words carefully. There may have been people on contract who prior to the COVID outbreak thought that they could proceed to greener pastures and other airlines and who had given their resignations. My friend Mr. Jain, the CMD, when he came under pressure and he had to cut costs, he did not renew their contracts. Now that's his decision, and I think anyone in his place would have done the same thing. Because if you decided prior to COVID that you wanted a job elsewhere, and then COVID came and we need to cut expenditure, we have more pilots than necessary, those are the first people, he didn't renew their contract. Now some of them argued that, no, but we had withdrawn our resume, which is neither here nor there. Then some of them have gone to court also. Well, we'll see with that. Other than that, there has been not a single layoff by Air India. I say this as a concerned minister because, you know, I have to deal with this in Parliament. Look at what the other airlines did, the private carriers. The most successful private airlines, which accounts for well more than 50% of market share, took commercial decisions. They are very much in their right to do so. They laid off 10% of their workforce, something like 2,700 people were laid off. And they had a drastic salary cut also. It's a commercial decision. It's not only a successful Indian carrier, this has happened all over the world. If you look at some of the most successful names in civil aviation, they are in trouble. Some of them are facing the prospects of closing down. Now, what does the government do in this? You run a successful commercial operation, you do well, we all rejoice in that success, okay? But those are your commercial decisions and you get the profits of that. Tomorrow, there are losses. Government, which is based on taxpayers' revenue, government cannot take those over. I have one airport operator who sometimes sends me a message saying, look at the third bailout in which is taking place in country X. I said, well, you know, that's a $20 trillion economy. But you know, look at us. I said, you know, look at us. What are we doing? We are feeding 800 million people. These are exact figures, huh? For a period of 9 months. That's who we are. Now, but that's why I read out all the actions that we had taken on aviation turbine fuel, bringing down GST. Those are things we've done. Not only whether my friend Arvind, who's the Airports Authority Chairman, or the airlines with whom we work very closely. The only answer to the economic difficulties of this sector are resume activity as quickly as you can, because then you have the ability to write off the losses. If one full quarter has been a loss, I don't know. We closed down on March. You, through our system, we've had many meetings. You see where the government comes in. Well, I'm going to just give you those comments. Rajiv, you want to add anything on your...
I think, sir, there are more questions we are having.
Nothing. Okay.
So better be okay. Move to the next question. 14.
What is your question?
I have specific questions for Air India and AAI. My question to Air India is, you know, it's been operating Vande Bharat flights at a time the fleets of all airlines were grounded. What is the, what are the earnings out of these international flights?
Yeah, he'll give you that.
Similarly, for AAI, it's been asked to defer payments to various airlines and it has to seek loan for its own working capital requirements when year after year, Airports Authority of India is cash positive. Can you please throw some light on that also?
Yeah, you can give the figures. As far as Airports Authority of India having cash project, they've also had to borrow money.
Okay, let me try and address some of the issues that you've raised. So, you know, COVID happened and the ban on restrictions on international as well as domestic operations happened sometime in March. We did an assessment of how our revenues and operations would pan out during the year 2021. And we estimated that the first half of the year, the first half, which is Q1 and Q2 of 2021, would be very challenging. And we expected that our revenue for the first half, H1, half yearly report, that is April to September, would be about 25%. In Q3, we expected that our operations would be at about 50%, and in Q4 at about 75% of pre-COVID level. So I'm comparing with previous financial year, that is 19-20. We've done half year, September is over, and we are pretty much at par with our projection. So we had projected that half year we will have 25% of our revenue as compared to last year, and we've achieved that. So we are on schedule as to what we had planned. A more specific figure, if you want, our Vande Bharat revenues and domestic revenues are kind of intertwined. It's difficult to separate them, but been a bit moderate. We domestic operations have ramped up. We are at about 40% of our pre-COVID capacity. We are adding 40. We are adding capacity every day. In October, we have added more capacity. Our target, as I said, was 50% of our capacity of last year. We are on par with that, and we expect that we will be able to bring in that capacity. To bring in more specificity, we were offering about 40,000 seats pre-COVID in the domestic. We are offering about 21,000 seats in October. So we are kind of on track with our projection. So, but it's not to say that it's not challenging. It's obviously challenging. Revenues are not as much as what it was last year, and but we have projected something. We have made a considered projection, and if we keep on track with that, I think that's a task well achieved. Thank you. From Airport Authority.
As far as the Airports Authority of India is concerned, you know that the first 2 months of this financial year were in the lockdown period, and so in the first quarter itself, there was a revenue shortfall of about 80% compared to the previous quarter. So there was a decline of 80%, so we only got 20% of what we had earned in the first quarter. It improved, but it has still not crossed the 50% mark in the second quarter. So there is definitely, I mean, even though we have always been profit making and dividend paying, we faced a resource crunch because of the lack of business activity. A, their number of flights are not there. Secondly, we whatever money we get from the concessions that we give for food and beverage and retail at our airports, those are on a revenue sharing model also. And with declining business there, those revenues have also come down. That's why we had to go in for this working capital loan. But this month we expect some upfront payment on account of the privatization of 3 airports, and that will be a significant amount of money that will be coming to us. And we expect those airports to be taken over by 12th of November. And so I don't think going forward, once the flying activity resumes, the commercial activities at the airports resume, and we get this upfront payment, I think the situation will ease in the future.
But I must share with you, not in relation to this question, but something otherwise. Whenever I talk to the airline operators, and which is often enough, they always say, ki, you know, make sure airports don't charge us this, that, and the other. So when I ask them, then where do you expect the airport authority? So I occasionally ask Arvind, bhai, wo airline wale kehle, aap ye mat karo, wo mat charge karo. So he said, sir, what is your suggestion? Where should I go? I have an answer which I won't share with you now, but in a lighter vein. Look, this is common. Whenever there is a period of economic or financial challenge, everybody looks as if the cost should be passed a little on to the other person. But if you're running a transparent system based on well-defined criteria, there are limits to what you can do. But as I said, the answer is...
Sir, please, sir.
Sir, I'm Ajit Jha.
Sir.
ऐसा जस्ट लेट अस फिनिश इट, दो क्वेश्चन ले लेते हैं उसके बाद में आप कर लीजिएगा, ठीक है? 14 इज ऑलरेडी स्पीकिंग यस क्वेश्चन।
सर मैं अजीत झा हूँ UNI वार्ता से। एक तो सर एयरपोर्ट अथॉरिटी ऑफ इंडिया से रिलेटेड मेरा सवाल है कि कुछ एयरलाइंस ने ये कहा था कि कुछ चार्जेज जो हैं उनके वेव ऑफ कर दिए जाएं, न सिर्फ डेफर किए जाएं वेव ऑफ कर दिए जाएं, तो उसका क्या है, उस पर क्या स्टेटस है? और दूसरा सर एयर इंडिया को लेकर के है कि बार बार ये कह करके कोविड सिचुएशन है इसलिए जो प्रोस्पेक्टिव बिडर हैं वो कह रहे हैं कि डेट आगे बढ़ाई जाए, लेकिन कल ही जैसे रेलवे का एक RFQ ओपन हुआ, काफ़ी अच्छा रिस्पांस आया था, तो जब दूसरे एरियाज में बिडिंग हो रही है सक्सेसफुली हो रही है, तो एयर इंडिया को लेकर के क्या सिचुएशन अलग है कि इसकी डेट्स आगे बढ़ाए जा रहे हैं बार बार?
Why don't you answer on the first one then?
Right now there is with the waiving off is not something that we are considering. But as you know, we have put, because of some problems of some airlines, they are on cash and carry. That every day, whatever they are doing, some airlines are paying whatever amount there so that their dues don't mount us. But their past dues are covered in terms of the security, the bank guarantees and other things that we have. So we are secure in that way. And we are in discussions with these airlines how to, you know, deal with these past dues. And they have their own suggestions about, some kind of deferrals of some payments or concessions on certain payments. So there is a dialogue that we are carrying on with these, specifically these two airlines, on how to clear the past dues.
No, but if I were in your place, I'd say waive off. Why? Why? I mean, if you run into a loss somewhere, why should the airline airport authority say? Then he runs into a loss and he comes to the government. So since we're having a discussion, it's an informal discussion, I'll tell you, first of all, we must get rid of this tendency. When we started Vande Bharat flights, there was a suggestion, why are you charging people? There are people in distress. So all right, if you don't charge them, then somebody will have to pay, because the airline has to pay salaries, it has to pay costs on the leasing of the aircraft, has to pay for ATF. So as long as we are clear in our minds that the cost has to be borne, the rest is an adjustment issue. And if the airline is, a particular airline is having difficulty today, they can tell him ki bhai aise cash and carry abhi karo aur pass ka jo hai uska plan bana do. So that's the spirit. Insofar as your Air India bidding and private, I don't think the facts are correct. All I can tell you, and I'll let Secretary answer. You tried privatization in the past, but if I may say so on record now, it was a half-hearted attempt. If you want to sell an entity which is incurring losses, and you turn around and say, main isme se 25% ye nahi bechunga, isme se baki ye nahi karenge, and you only want to pass off your liabilities onto the prospective bidder, obviously the people will have doubts. This is a more serious bid, and this time we will ensure it goes through. The delay kyun hi, Secretary sahab batayenge, aur delay nahi hui actually if you look at it.
No, I think there is no delay in the process. Now, what has happened is after the full impact of COVID and after lockdown, it was the bidders who approached the transaction advisor, and they requested that their experts are not able to come to India. They're not able to come and analyze and discuss. So they requested for more time. That's point number one. Point number two, what they said was with COVID, with the onset of COVID, there has been a severe impact on the aviation industry. And we have been basically trying to give them some time so that our interest is that we get good bids and competitive bids.
Last question, 37.
Sir, I'm Ashok from ANI. Is there any comment or updates regarding Air India Express crash?
Air India's?
Express crash.
Well, I think you're all aware of the unfortunate incident that happened. I don't plan to go into the details of, or I can also, there were 190 passengers on board, 21 passengers, including two pilots, died. Well, almost everybody has been discharged from the hospital. There are two passengers who continue to be receiving some treatment in the hospital, one in Calicut and one in Coimbatore. One of the passengers is undergoing physiotherapy, and one of the passengers is undergoing some plastic surgery. So these are kind of post post-accident corrective surgeries and corrective treatment which is underway. We, the insurance agency has paid to all the injured as well as the family members of the deceased. Some of them were grievously injured, others were not so grievously injured. And all of them have been paid an interim compensation already. We have also received an interim compensation for the aircraft that we lost. The first tranche of that has been received. And yes, that's all. Anything specific that you are looking for?
No, I think investigation part will not be given in the press conferences. Let's leave it to the investigation side. Thank you very much, sir. And some of the friends who could not be given the answer, please, Rajiv Jain will take care. He will provide you the answers, ADG. Thank you very much, sir.
One minute. First of all, I have a 1:30 appointment, so any questions you have, send them to Rajiv Jain.
Yes,
I'll be very happy to personally vet the answers before they come to you. Anji. वो मैं कह देता हूँ आई हाँ बट जल्दी में एंड सोशल डिस्टेंस्ड सोशली डिस्टेंस मैं यहीं से बोल देता हूँ और मेरी अगर हिंदी में कोई कमी रह गई तो हमारे सचिव जो महोदय जो हैं इनकी हिंदी बहुत ही मैं वो बता देता हूँ हाँ देखिए 23 मार्च के याद कर रहा हूँ तकरीबन 3 लाख थी थोड़ से ज़्यादा 3,20,000 लॉकडाउन के बाद 23 मार्च के लॉकडाउन के बाद डोमेस्टिक फ्लाइट्स हमने 25 मई को दोबारा शुरू की थी उस समय 30,000 पैसेंजर एक दिन में कई हफ्ते या 30,000 के आसपास फिगर रही जो हमारा लेटेस्ट फिगर जो मुझे याद है 2 या 3 अक्टूबर का उस समय हम करीब 1,80,000 के आंकड़े पर पहुंच गए थे जब हमने सिविल एविएशन सेक्टर को खोला था तो उस समय हमारा इरादा था कि 33% कैपेसिटी खोली जाएगी पहली फेज में उसको बढ़ा के हमने 50% किया और उसके बाद हम शायद 60-65% भी फ्लाइट्स अभी खोली जा रही हैं मेरा आपसे मेरी असेसमेंट है और आपसे आपको मैं सबमिट करना चाहता हूं कि जिस तरीके से डिमांड बढ़ रही है और हम फ्लाइट चला सकते हैं खास करके महाराष्ट्र कोविड से पहले मुंबई हवाई अड्डा जो है वो एक दिन में 1,000 मूवमेंट्स लेता था 500 अराइवल्स और 500 डिपार्चर और मैंने बहुत कोशिश की मुख्यमंत्री जी इसको कन्विंस करने के लिए पर उनकी जो ओपनिंग थी थोड़ी कैलिब्रेटेड और स्लो थी तो 25 मई को उन्होंने 25 फ्लाइट्स अराइवल 25 डिपार्चर की मंजूरी दी थी हमें उसको बढ़ा के हम ले गए थे 50 अराइवल 50 डिपार्चर तक कुछ ही दिन पहले वहाँ से एक सूचना आई है कि वो प्री कोविड लेवल के 30% तक ले जाने को तैयार है उसका मतलब है दिन में 300 मूवमेंट तो अगर अभी 100 मूवमेंट है तो 200 फ्लाइट्स बढ़ेंगी महाराष्ट्र में तो इनको बढ़ने में भी मेरे को लगता है 2-4 दिन और लगेंगे तो और अगर अभी जो फिगर्स हैं हमारी डेली फिगर 1.5 लाख और 1,80,000 के बीच में है तो मुझे उम्मीद है कि महीने के आखिर तक हम 2 लाख फिगर पर पहुंच जाएंगे विच इज अबाउट 60-65% और मैंने फिर ये आपके साथ असेसमेंट शेयर की कि दिवाली जो 15 नवंबर के आसपास है दिवाली से लेके साल के अखीर तक 31 दिसंबर तक मुझे पूरी उम्मीद है कि हम प्री कोविड फिगर जो है 3 लाख उस पर पहुंच जाएंगे बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद
धन्यवाद सर थैंक यू फ्रेंड्स